Hey everybody, this is my second video on probability, and I'd like to discuss the fundamentals of computing probabilities involving the operations AND, OR, and NOT, which correspond to our set operations of intersection, union, and complement. Previously we discussed three different definitions for probability, and in this video I'm only going to be using our definition for where the probability of E equals the cardinality of E divided by the cardinality of our sample space, where we assume outcomes are equally likely. So let's start with the OR operator, which corresponds to the set operation union. In order to compute the probability of event A or event B, we're going to need to compute the cardinality of the union of A and B. Initially, let's suppose that A and B are two disjoint sets. That is, they do not overlap. In the study of probability, when our sets correspond to disjoint events, we say that the events are mutually exclusive. In this case, it's easy enough to see that the number of things in A union B is just the number of things in A plus the number of things in B. Now we can divide everything by the number of things in our sample space. This is a trick we're going to use several times in this video. And we get that the probability of A union B equals the probability of A plus the probability of B. For obvious reasons, this is called the addition rule for probability. But what if our sets are not mutually exclusive? Now we can't just add the cardinalities together. You can see in this example that the number of things in A union B is 7, which is not equal to the 4 things in A plus the 5 in B. The problem, of course, is that we've counted the elements where they overlap twice. So now we have to use the more general formula from set theory, that the number of things in A union B is the number of things in A plus the number of things in B minus the number of things in A intersect B, where we subtract off the duplicated region. Now we can divide by the number of things in our sample space again and get our general addition formula. The probability of A union B equals the probability of A plus the probability of B minus the probability of A intersect B. Here's an example. Suppose we did a survey on gender and political affiliation for a class of 200 students and got the results shown in the table. If a single student is picked at random, what's the probability that they are a Democrat or an Independent? And what's the probability that they are a woman or a Democrat? In the first case, you can see that the events Democrat and Independent are mutually exclusive. So all we have to do is add together their respective probabilities. That is 100 over 200 plus 30 over 200, which is about 0.65. In the second case, the events overlap, so we need to subtract off the duplicated values corresponding to a woman and a Democrat. So now we get 80 over 200 plus 100 over 200 minus 40 over 200, which equals about 0.7. Another example can be seen with cards. If we're drawing a single card from a standard deck of 52, then the probability of a club or a jack is not mutually exclusive, since it's possible to have a club and a jack. Hence, we have to use the general addition formula to get the probability of a club plus the probability of a jack minus the probability of a club and a jack, which works out to 13 over 52 plus 4 over 52 minus 1 over 52, and eventually 4 thirteenths. Suppose instead we consider the event drawing something less than 4. We can equate this to getting an ace or a 2 or a 3 on a single draw. Now, these are mutually exclusive events, since, for instance, you can't draw a 2 and a 3. So the probability will just be the sum of each of these, which is 4 52nds. So the probability will be 12 over 52, or 3 thirteenths. Our next operand is the NOT, or complement operation. We know that the union of E and E prime will be our entire sample space, and also that E and E prime are mutually exclusive. So then the number of things in E plus the number of things in E prime is just going to equal the number of things in our sample space. Or dividing by the number of things in our sample space again, we see that the probability of E plus the probability of E prime is equal to 1. Usually we write this in the form probability of E equals 1 minus the probability of E prime, since this is how it's most often used. The idea here is that sometimes it's easier to calculate the probability of the complement and then use the result of the formula above to find the probability we're actually looking for. Consider this example with a bowl of M&Ms. M&Ms. Suppose we have 4 blue, 5 red, and 6 green M&Ms. If we reach in and grab 3 at random, what's the probability of getting at least 1 green? Note, whenever you see the words at least or at most in a problem, you might want to consider looking at the complement. In this case, the complement of getting at least 1 green is that we get no greens. This means that everything we choose must come from our set of 9 remaining red and blue M&Ms. The probability of this is fairly easy to compute using our combination formula. It's all the ways that we can choose 3 things from a set of 9 things divided by all the ways we can choose 3 things from a set of 15, since we have 15 total M&Ms. So the probability of no greens reduces down to 12 over 65, And the probability that we're really looking for will be 1 minus 12 over 65, or 53 65ths, which is 0.815. So you have about an 81% chance of getting at least one grain. Finally, we want to talk about the AND operation, which corresponds to intersection. But before we do that, we need to introduce the idea of conditional probability. We use conditional probability when the sample space for our event contains too much information. It's so large that any useful information we might glean from the probability is lost. So what we do is we consider the same event with a more limited sample space. We denote this B slash A, where the slash is read as given. So the probability of B slash A means the probability of B given A, or the probability of B limited to the smaller sample space A. An example of this can be seen in medicine. The probability that someone chosen at random in the US has sickle cell anemia is about 1 out of 5,000, which doesn't sound too bad. However, if we limit the sample space to African Americans, the chances that you get sickle cell jump up to 1 out of 500. And you can see that you might be much more at risk than the first probability implied. So while in general the probability of B is equal to the number of things in B over the number of things in S, and we consider the probability of B given A, our new denominator will be determined by the smaller sample space A, and our numerator will only be concerned with the portion of B that lies inside of A. Hence, the probability of B given A will be the number of things in A intersect B divided by the number of things in A. Consider this example. We surveyed 200 people about their blood types and came up with the breakdown shown in the table. Now, suppose that one person is picked at random. What are the probabilities of the following? The probability that the person has type AB, the probability that they have type O given that they're Rh negative, the probability that they're Rh negative given that they're type AB. In our first case, there's no restriction, so we can just consider the entire sample space. The probability of type AB is just the total number of type AB people divided by the total number of samples, which is 12 over 200, or about 6%. In our second case, however, the probability of type O given that they're Rh negative, we're limiting our sample space to the set of people that are Rh negative. So we only need to look at the numbers on the second row. The probability of type O given the Rh negative equals the number of people that are type O divided by the total number, which in this case is 10 over 26. Notice that the totals are now coming from our restricted space. It's like you pulled everyone that was Rh negative to one side and said, now in this group, what is the probability that you're type O? And finally, the probability that they're Rh negative given that they're type AB is found by limiting our sample space to the set of people with type AB blood. Hence, the probability equals the number of Rh negatives in our sample space divided by the total in the sample space, which is 2 over 12. So now we're ready to get a rule for AND. If we start with our formula for conditional probability, we saw above that the probability of B given A was the number of things in A intersect B divided by the number of things in A. Dividing the numerator and denominator by a number of things in our sample space, we get the probability of B given A equals the probability of A intersect B divided by the probability of A. Or multiplying by the probability of A, we get our general multiplication rule that the probability of A intersect B equals the probability of A times the probability of B given A. So intersection is going to become a product of probabilities. Note that the events A and B in this formula should be thought of as belonging to separate consecutive experiments. Here's an example with 9 marbles in a jar, which 5 are green and 4 are blue. We want to take 2 marbles out, one right after the other. We'll consider 2 cases. In one case, we'll keep the first marble out while we make the second pick. For the second case, we'll replace the first marble back in the jar before making the second pick. We want to know the probability of getting 2 blue marbles in each of these cases. In both cases, we want the probability of a blue on the first pick and a blue on the second pick. Based on our formula for AND, this should be the probability of a blue on the first pick times the probability of a blue on the second pick, given that we got a blue on the first pick. The probability of a blue on the first pick is obviously just 4 out of 9. The problem comes with the second pick. If we get a blue on the first pick and do not replace it, then there's now only 3 marbles, blue marbles, and 8 marbles total in the jar. So the probability of a blue on the second pick, given that we got a blue on the first pick, is 3 out of 8. Hence, the probability of a blue and a blue would be 4/9 times 3/8, or 1/6. If, however, we replace the blue marble after the first pick, then the probability for the second blue is the same as the first. So the probability of a blue and a blue would be 4/9 times 4/9, which is 16 over 81. You can see from the second case that sometimes the first experiment has no influence over the next one. For example, if you're rolling a single die several times, the probability of what you roll the second time is not affected by what you rolled the first time. In this type of situation, we say that the events A and B are independent. or mathematically, the probability of B given A is equal to the probability of B. If the events A and B are independent, then we can simplify our multiplication rules so that the probability of A intersect B is just equal to the probability of A times the probability of B. Now, people tend to get mutually exclusive and independent events mixed up. Mutually exclusive means that they cannot happen simultaneously in a single experiment, like selecting an ace and a jack on a single draw. The probability in this case of A and B is equal to zero. However, mutually exclusive events means that one event does not affect the other in consecutive experiments, like rolling a single die. The probability of A and B is equal to the probability of A times the probability of B, which is typically not zero. Before we finish up, let's summarize what we've discussed so far. We have two addition formulas for OR, which we use for a single experiment, and two multiplication formulas for AND, which we use on multiple experiments. We use our formula for NOT when the complement's easier to compute than the original event. Unfortunately, both our addition and multiplication rules use the word AND, so you have to remember the context. Okay, one final example. Consider a basketball player making free throws. I'll pick on Shaq because he's known for having a notoriously bad free throw. At one point, his free throw average, which is the probability he'll make a basket, was about 53%. In basketball, there's a period when fouled players are given a one-on-one shot. This means they get one shot, and if they make it, then they get a second shot. If they miss the first one, they're done. So what's the probability in a one-on-one situation that Shaq will make either 0 points, 1 point, or 2 points? In order for Shaq to make 0 points, that means he misses the first shot. Hence, we can use our rule for not, since the probability that he misses the first shot is 1 minus the probability that he makes a basket, which is 1 minus 0.53 or 0.47. In order to make 1 point, he must make the first basket and miss the second. These are independent events, so we just need to multiply the respective probabilities. That is, the probability that he makes the first and misses the second equals the probability that he makes the first times the probability that he misses the second, which is 0.53 times 0.47 or 0.249. And finally, in order to make 2 points, he must make both shots. So the probability that he makes the first and makes the second equals the probability that he makes the first times the probability that he makes the second, which is 0.53 times 0.53, or 0.281. So I hope this helped clarify the appropriate formulas for solving probability problems involving the operands AND, OR, and NOT. Please feel free to add comments or suggestions, and thank you for watching.